Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining me this evening for my professorial chair lecture. This is my first lecture as holder of the Francisco Yatco Chair in Entrepreneurship. So in the next hour or so, I'll share with you some of my current thinking on this theory which I developed in 2008 and how my thinking has been changing a bit because of my exposure to critical realism. And then I look forward to your questions and your reactions to some of my ideas. So by way of outline, I will just cover the following points. I'll give you first a perspective of why I got into humanistic entrepreneurship research. And then I'll review the theory. For those of you who haven't had a chance to read it, you might find the review helpful. And then I'll take a philosophical side turn, and I hope you can stay awake while I do this, no? Because my main idea here is I think the future of the theory is limited if I stick to my original conception, which was a positivist view of knowledge, and I think it will be more fruitful to develop it moving forward using this perspective that I have learned recently called critical realism. And then we'll look at a particular case of a manager that I've been following closely recently, since I got to meet him and I got to invite him to give us a talk in a conference we organized. And I think he has a lot of experience which we can use to flesh out what the theory claims, right, about what humanistic entrepreneurship means. And then we'll have an open forum. First, the review. When I thought about developing this theory back in 2008, I was really coming from an institutional perspective, meaning what is the role of business in the Philippine setting? And you know, when you look at Republican democracies, a good starting point is this document called the Constitution. So I looked at it, and in Article 12, it says that property bears a social function. So meaning money is social, and all economic agents shall contribute to the common good. It enumerates who these agents are: individuals, private groups, including corporations, cooperatives, and similar organizations. So the Constitution recognizes that all of us have the right to own, establish, and operate economic enterprises. So we are not a communist country, right? Private enterprise is encouraged. In fact, it is a centerpiece of our Constitution. However, the common good principle is emphasized. And if the common good is in jeopardy, the state is to intervene. I always like to think of a pizza, you know. This is about near dinner time, so if we invited pizza, we would make sure everybody had a piece, right? Now, if I get three pieces, so much so that maybe one of our friends here will not get a piece, maybe he will remind me, please get only one piece because he doesn't have one yet, right? So I think you get the idea of what the common good is. It means that everybody should have access to what they need as human beings. And I think food is a basic need. Would you agree? Yes, okay. And also, aligned with the Constitution, we have the Corporation Code, one of our fundamental laws which operationalize what we mean by the common good. And the Corporation Code of 1980 states that business corporations are not merely established for private gain. All the emphasis are mine. The code does not appear in red. But to be effective partners of the national government in spreading the benefits of capitalism. So notice that the Corporation Code and the Constitution says the same thing, right? We are all encouraged to have economic enterprises, but the idea always is to spread the benefit, make sure everybody has a share of the fruits of such business activities so that we can develop as a nation. Now, when I was also formulating the theory, I was also guided by Catholic social teaching. In particular, St. John Paul II propounded key principles that you will see reflected in the theory. For example, he said that human work is the key, probably the essential key to the whole social question. So when the popes refer to the social question, they refer to the income inequality. Right? If you look at industrial countries, one of the striking things about them is that the more they develop, the more unequal income becomes, right? It's one of those paradoxes. in the U.S., considered the most economically advanced country, and a showcase of industrial development, income inequality has been increasing. So much so that you have had the 99% versus the 1%, right? This is the movement that they call the, they have riots on Wall Street and several other cities around the U.S. Executives now can earn as much as 400 times the salary of an average worker. And it's only growing with every decade. So what the Pope is saying here is that the key to the common good is to make sure everybody has work. So Catholic social teaching is not really saying that let's all go out and give dole outs or just give alms to the poor, although that's welcome as charitable acts. But the key really is to make sure that the economy enables everybody to gain decent work, which allows them to have what they need to grow as human beings. And then later on, he followed it up with another statement in Centesimus Annus. The first one was In Laborem Exercens. And here he clarifies it further. He says, the purpose of a business firm is not simply to make a profit, but is to be found in its very existence as a community of persons who in various ways are endeavoring to satisfy their basic needs and who form a particular group at the service of the whole of society. So you can see that it's a very integrative vision of business, right? Of course, profit is there, but not the only thing that we think about. It is also a group of people who behave in a different way towards each other. They're like a family. A community is a structural relationship characterized by high trust, right? Like when you go to your home each night, you have this feeling that you belong. You can say hello to your neighbors and expect them to say hello back. Do they say hello back when you say hello to your neighbors? Yeah. Maybe not. No? Maybe they hide. No? Maybe they owe you money. But in most cases, we look forward to going home because we feel safe. We feel we belong. In the Pope's vision, he feels that the workplace is the same. It's a place where when you go, you feel you're comfortable, you're accepted for who you are. People attend to your needs. People are sensitive to you and so on. But of course, businesses are not country clubs, right? They're not just there to feel good. They must provide a valuable service or product to society. So if you're a telco, you are to provide reliable mobile phone service. If you're a hotel, you're to provide clean rooms and good billing, you know. If you're a taxi, if you're Uber, you're to provide reliable transport from point A to point B, all of that. So those are the key elements in a business. Now, the role of the entrepreneur was also emphasized in Catholic social thought. Let me just highlight a few things here, especially when he says, a person who produces something other than for his own use generally does so in order that others may use it after they have paid a just price. It is precisely the ability to foresee both the needs of others and the combinations of factors so that the service can be given to others is what is a modern source of wealth in modern society. So in effect, Pope John Paul is almost saying that an entrepreneur is like a modern day hero. You know, in other words, we don't need the X-Men or Batman. Entrepreneurs are heroes every day because they go out of their way to make their lives more difficult in the belief that they can come up with something that make the lives of others easier, right? So, for example, even a magtataho, just imagine a magtataho, no? Biking around every day or carrying that heavy load every day. Just because people love taho, I love taho. And so when I see the magtataho, my heart jumps, you know, with joy. And so I order 2 cups right away. But we have to pause and reflect how difficult it is for him every day to do that. With businesses, department stores, they have to prepare the shelves every day, stock the shelves every day, balance their accounts every day. So they make it so easy for us, but we often cannot imagine what goes on behind closed doors. Entrepreneurs really are always calculating. Should I buy more of this? If I just go to a modern restaurant, right? And sometimes you're the only customer there, and they've cooked so much, right? So already you're thinking, my gosh, so what happens to the capital that they put into the food that they... These are part of the risks. And yet the next day, they're open again. See, so while we can just walk in, if we don't like the food, we just walk out. We don't absorb that kind of risk, but they do. So the initiative and entrepreneurial ability is increasingly evident and decisive. So you can see that the amount of time that St. John Paul spends to extolling the entrepreneur is very substantial. In prior Catholic writings, they would characterize business leaders as almost like belonging to the dark side of the force. You know, they were almost like a malevolent presence in society. But if you look at modern day Catholic teachings, they're almost portrayed as lifesavers. And I think if you review the previous slides, you would know why. Because businesses create jobs. And remember, the argument is that jobs are the key to the social question. The only way to eliminate social inequality is to have more decent jobs. So we need more entrepreneurs building and creating, building businesses and creating jobs. So of course, when the jobs are created, we need to check if they are decent jobs. So these are the elements we need to look at. Do the jobs provide the following? So of course, productivity is essential. We will not give a job to somebody who will just collect pay every 15th and 30th but not do anything, right? That's called son of owner jobs, right? So they're not real jobs. No? So a real job is one where you can feel that at the end of the day you did something useful for others and you feel good. So that when you collect your pay, you know that it's a fair exchange, right? And your potential is growing every time you go to work. You know, you don't have that feeling that, you know, every birthday you feel that, oh, I've worked 360 days and I'm exactly the same person. Or maybe I'm even worse. My health is worse, I have fewer friends, my wife just left me, and so on and so forth. And this happens. A lot of people devote so much to their work, it destroys their health, destroys their homes. So that's not the kind of work we're looking at. And of course, the work should provide a dignified life, meaning you don't feel like you're a cog in a machine or somebody who just takes instructions. You know, sometimes when I go and buy from the... If you walk around campus, you see a lot of vending machines, right? And of course, when you buy from vending machines, what do? You drop a coin, and then you wait for the nice product to come out, right? And then what happens if it doesn't come out? What do? Well, you persuade it. And then if you cannot persuade it, by pushing the button, you begin to hit it a little bit. And then you check if there's CCTV, and here there's CCTV everywhere, so you have to know the angle so that when you kick it, it will not be seen in the CCTV. Well, you know, sometimes workers in companies feel a bit that way, right? You're told to do something, and the reasoning is, anyway, you're paid, so you better do that. But, you know, human beings are not vending machines, right? They're gifted with reason, they have a heart, so they feel for things. So you have to make sure that work doesn't just give you a job and salary, it must give you dignity as well. And you must feel that you have a fair share of the fruits of the work. As I said, in many companies, the top executive can earn as much as 400 times the average employee. Now, of course, some people find that acceptable, but I think most ethicists would say there's something essentially wrong with such a high ratio of the highest pay to the lowest pay. Voice is important, and this is not a mediocre voice. No? This means if there is a policy, you were consulted, especially if it affects you. Of course, it doesn't mean that your input will be accepted, but at least your voice was heard. And that's very important because humans have a need to count, to be significant. And although they will grant that the manager has a final say, it still helps them if they have a chance to express their inputs. And of course, people do not just work for themselves. They do go home to families. They have dreams for their children. They want to take vacations with their spouses, all of that. That's part of what work provides. And of course, during those difficult times, you might get sick, or a flood might destroy your home. You hope that because you are working, that you will have health insurance, you will have, you know, access to credit so that you can recover your losses and so on. And of course, this is also important. When you go to work, you make friends, right? Most people, in fact, meet their future spouses in a work setting. So I even asked our MBA students here, tell me, it's not just academics you're here for, right? So you're also here to make friends, so very important. And we welcome this because a school, an organization is where people mix with each other and therefore they grow as human beings and they become connected to the wider social fabric. Okay, now of course we've been talking about the employees the whole time. But those conditions for work do not just happen by themselves. Somebody has to make them happen. And the key actor in that scenario is the manager himself. But what kind of manager are we talking about? Well, we're talking about a particular kind of manager. A manager who has what we call a moral compass. And his decisions, his actions are guided by a certain mindset, which is often described as virtue. So virtue is a use of actions that are always oriented towards a good, right? So when a business man decides on something, like should I deliver this product? So he asks himself, okay, who is this product for? Okay, this is for adults, but what if kids eat it? Well, it may not be good for them. So we have to make sure that kids don't have access to this food, right? So in the way he displays the food item, in the way he labels it, he will make sure that kids will not have access to it. So that's part of what they think about managers. So it's not just something that, okay, this is a nice product, we can make money out of it. In particular, of course, I'm referring to alcoholic beverages, right? Alcohol companies make a lot of money, but they have to be very careful that the young do not have access to these products. Or if they do, they must be supervised by adults who will make sure that they don't abuse them. So these kinds of decisions are guided by what we call virtue. So a manager has a virtue if he has a stable disposition to act in a certain way. So a virtuous person is not a random acting person. He tends to have a certain pattern in the way he decides things. And that pattern is developed through everyday reflection so that he or she tends to make similarly good decisions. So these are some of the questions that go through a virtuous manager's mind. You know, what am I? Every time he acts, he's asking himself, what is the purpose of that action? So if I'll bring this product to market, what for? Is there a need that it will serve? And then, how will I deliver the product? What am I actually bringing to the market? Notice that he's actually matching whether the purpose that he has in mind is aligned with how he will do it. And then he also looks at the circumstances. What are the particular circumstances? I am reminded of one multinational who sells infant formula, right? They sold this very popular infant formula in a developing country, but in a very poor country, actually, in Africa. So the problem was, to make infant formula, you need clean water. Now, they did not investigate that clean water was not available. So if you mix water that is not clean with this infant formula, you're actually essentially making poison for children. And sure enough, a lot of young children died or had their kidneys destroyed. So this multinational, who will remain unnamed, you can just Google it because it's a famous case. They learn from that. Sure, you have a good product and you want to help children and mothers, but maybe you have to look at the circumstances, right? Will it fit in that market? Of course, we know that eventually even the health community rallied to prevent infant formula from being offered to mothers who have just given birth. They told the multinational, stay away from the mother. She has to have the first choice of nursing her children, because that's very important, right, for health reasons. So even if you are a well-intended manufacturer of infant formula, you have to ask, is it for a good purpose? Am I doing it the right way? And is it being done in a way that's sensitive to the circumstances? So I hope that gives you an idea what are entailed by virtuous decision making. Okay, let me just go more quickly through some of these slides because they build up on the same point. essentially, when we are talking about humanism, we're really looking at the dignity of work, right? So this person is doing a lot of work. This reminds me of how I feel sometimes, like when I was preparing for this lecture. I have to produce the work. I have to give this lecture because I hold a chair, and a chair is a duty, right? It's a, in universities, if you hold a chair, it's almost like a sacred duty to deliver like a homily. And if you're in a company, you do a certain type of work because the company counts on you also to deliver certain results. In this case, it might be a market share, it might be a financial performance. In most models of management, it stops there. And this is the problem, because if this is how we look at work, the tendency is this guy will slowly burn out, right? Because we're not conscious about how the work itself is affecting him. So the innovation in humanistic management is that we look at not only the objective function of work, which is to produce output, because after all, we were told to exercise dominion over the earth, right? We need to make it productive for our benefit. But also to check what is happening to the person himself. So a good question I always ask people is, when are you happier, Monday mornings or Friday afternoons? Maybe I can ask our friends
here. No-brainer. It's a no-brainer.
Okay. Normally, if I ask any question, people take a long time to answer. But this question, they answer instantly. They're happier on Friday afternoons. Now, that's a paradox, right? Because we spend easily one third to a half of our waking time at work every day. And yet, we don't seem to be too happy with it, or we can't wait for it to end. So, but I think, as my colleague here says, it's a no-brainer because oftentimes work burns us out. In other words, we don't feel we grow from work. It's drudgery. It's something that you just have to do because you have to get the funds you need to eat, right? And ultimately, some authors find that a tragic perspective. Because, as I said, we spend a lot of our waking hours at work. So, therefore, when we look at work, and this is a main motivation of the theory that I developed, is that work cannot be a simple commodity. It's not something that you just produce. Again, human beings are not vending machines. Human beings are creative partners in life itself. You know? The things you do at work, the reports you produce, even the way you answer a phone call, influences how the world works. That's why, even though they get a lot of criticisms, call center agents really have very important work. When you're operating your computer and then it doesn't work, and then you call a call center agent, and then she says very gently, sir, there's a switch there, which if you press, will turn on the machine. Oh, and then the customer says, oh, I didn't know that. Oh, thank you for bringing your problem to my attention, sir. I will expect your call next time, right? So instead of telling the person that maybe you should read the manual next time, because the whole point is that why the call center industry is the fastest growing industry in the world, because precisely people don't like to read manuals, right? Do you read the manuals of your cell phones? I doubt that very much. So there's a call center, you can make a friend. Of course, some will say, well, on page 46 of your manual, so you can already, there's a hint that maybe you shouldn't have called. In fact, this is even happening in banks. Sometimes I go to banks because I like to do business over the counter. And then the teller will say, sir, you could have done this online. So somehow I don't feel so welcome. Or maybe it's just me. Huh? And then I say, yeah, I know all about online banking. I've been doing it for a long time. But I came here to see your smile. So let's review. In the theory, I developed this idea into this framework of levels. So at level one, the idea in business is that we work through people. In fact, if you look at many management texts, certainly when I was studying management, we were always told management is achieving goals through people, right? So when you say through, people are instruments. They're like tools. And of course, when I was younger, I would memorize that definition, not knowing that it contains a philosophical bias, right? Because if you're working through people, it's like a vending machine. If somebody's there, Like if you're calling somebody in a call center, hey, look, I paid you. You better give me a good answer. Otherwise, I'm going to ban this phone. So these kinds of relationships often arise from this mentality. So the question is, well, I try to depict that here. He's not very happy because he's being told. He's being told, you have to do this. You have to do this. Anyway, we need the returns for the investors. So the question of the manager always, and the manager is always happy for some reason, right? Well, he's achieving his goals. And he's asking, are we on target? What are we achieving, right? Again, in management, we were told management has to make sure that we are effective and efficient, right? In fact, that's one of the first things that we management students are told to remember. Be effective and be efficient. But I argue that this is just one way of looking at management. In fact, I call this the instrumentalist view of management. I propose changing the word from working through to working with people. So here you build a team. So instead of inputs just being flowing one way, you ask the worker, and that's why he's smiling, because he has voice. You ask him what he thinks, and then you know, you get other departments to work with each other, right? And I think a lot of psychologists will say that if you have that kind of relationship in the workplace, people tend to feel better about the work. Maybe they will be happier on Monday than on Fridays, or maybe equally happy, at least. So here we expand it into a partnership concept. And the manager asks other questions. So what are we achieving, of course? Are we on target? But also, are we working with each other? So managers have to ask this question. They have to look at the quality of relationships. Now, the quality of relationships do not show up in financial statements, unfortunately. You cannot detect them in an income statement and a balance sheet. And a lot of businesses are obsessed with financial statements. I wish they would have a relationship statement, right? Although my wife always tells me, in your dreams. Well, that's me. Because that's easy to do. You can make that. You can ask your network manager. In fact, one company did it this way because they can track all the internal emails. So they just have a network map to show the density of emails across functional areas. So if you're all emailing within and you're not emailing others, it's a sign that most of the communication are within the department. So they have a very colored charts that show that, hey, look, sales and manufacturing are communicating more, but we hardly see anything between manufacturing and IT. Right, so this data is available. You just request your IT department to do it. They can give it routinely because the system generated automatically. But nobody asks for it. It's one of those things. But if we were interested in that, we should look at how people are collaborating. The third level, I call it working for people. And this is where we really bring in humanism. So in other words, notice I bring in a new color of arrow here. Earlier, it was just black, meaning everything is about work, output. But now, we bring in the green arrow to show that we're also interested in how people are developing, right? And we bring in the heart for the manager. I'll do that again so that you'll see it. Okay, so here we're saying that, you know, as I do the work, doing the work makes me feel good about myself, right? So if I'm a call center agent and I helped an old man to discover this thing called the power switch, I think I just made the life of a person better, right? Because not everybody knows where the switch is. I do, that's why I get paid, right? So why should I feel bad that he doesn't know? In fact, that's the only reason I get paid, because some people don't know. I should be happy, right? That should be the attitude. But, you know, if the management doesn't emphasize that heart of service, sometimes those who give service are irritated at the very people they serve. Which is paradoxical, right? Because the opportunity to serve should be valued. And so even the manager here feels that he is growing. They're all growing. That's why I'm indicating here that even as we are working, we are growing. So we become a community. So we're not just a team. A team just makes the work better for each other, right? But a community makes the work better for everyone's growth as human beings. And that's a level higher than just being a team. So, when you now are a team, you add the following questions. So remember, are we achieving? Are we on target? Are we working together? Are we developing as persons? And are we developing our culture? And this is the kicker here. What is the higher purpose that our meaning has for us? So some authors call this spiritual development, meaning, and this is where, you know, you might find it far-fetched. Some people are happier on Monday mornings. They go to work with a you know, spring in their step because they think the work they're doing is very important. It's meaningful to them. They have achieved a certain level of spiritual accomplishment in their work. So this is something that managers can help workers discover in the work. Okay, so how do we connect that vision of the workplace to society itself? So this is a diagram I use to evoke the high level of inequality in our society, where you have a few who have access to human growth, but many are struggling. They're below water here, symbolically. It means that they don't have access to the basic needs, right? To housing, to nutrition, to healthcare, to education. And so societies that are shaped like this tend to divide the population to those who are breathing or are being uplifted by the economy and those who are literally drowning or are exploited. In fact, in some societies, the only reason these people can have so much is because these people have so little. For example, most of the middle class can still afford to hire household help, right? But you know that the only reason we can do that is because many are poor. As countries develop, the availability of household help becomes lower and lower. In fact, you can be a very rich person in Manhattan and not be able to get good help. That's why in some cases, Americans even hire illegal immigrants because they cannot get their own citizens to accept domestic work, right? So if our society is like this, hopefully if we have more organizations that focus on level 3 management, which is working for people, we can begin to shape society. So we can grow from here to here and become this kind of society. So most industrial countries have achieved this. We're still waiting for our time. I know some of us aren't holding our breath, but I'm hopeful. I think it can be done. So the way to do it is to have organizations of the right shape. If you have organizations, if you have businesses that are of the same shape as society, I call them maintainers. They just maintain the inequality. If you have organizations that are shaped like this, meaning they push people up, they hire from the bottom and then give them opportunities to go up, I call them ameliorators. We are to avoid organizations like this, meaning it's almost like a monarchy there. Now you have a few at the very top with the finest of all opportunities, while the rest here exist in squalor and subhuman existence. Right, so this is something that we are to avoid. And again, the shape of businesses are influenced by the philosophy of the management. If you have managers who will uplift, those at the bottom will slowly move up. If you have managers who tend to legitimize exploitative actions, right, like excessive contractualization or depriving workers of health insurance and so on, this is what you have. So the big picture is that if our society can have more businesses that really follow what the Constitution says and what the principles of humanistic management says, we will have more organizations that will uplift. And finally, we achieve the vision of our society, which is a more equitable society as envisioned by the Constitution. So this is where the theory comes in. Given that backdrop, I ask myself, why is it that some businesses are managed by people who have, of course, they pay attention to profit, but somehow they look for more than profit. If you talk to the people who work in such companies, I remember I was buying something in this toy store in a mall, and then I was asking the cashier as I was paying how she found her work. And you know, when you talk to cashiers, they always answer questions, especially if you're about to pay. And I said, oh, are you okay here? Oh yeah, we're great here. And I said, what makes you say that? Well, you know, we have nice benefits, we get training. Oh, so why are things so good for you? Well, because our manager is decent. In fact, she went on to say, well, because my manager is Christian. But I think what she meant is still decent, right? So if you just interview workers around the metro, you can see that those who are thriving talk very positively about their superiors. Conversely, those who feel that they are burning out sometimes will not have kind words to say about it. This is a common observation I've made. So let's flesh out the theory. Essentially, we're looking at the growth of people, right? And we call this integral human development. So the first hypothesis is that this happens when the culture is ethical, meaning there is a certain sense of justice, respect for human dignity, fairness, and this is the first hypothesis of the theory. And for that to happen, you have to have business leaders who shape that culture. And there's a lot of research that shows that culture is shaped by the actions of very proactive managers. And of course, even if you have an entrepreneur leader who is a decent person, but if he is not conscious of how his behaviors affect the way he leads, then this effect is not as pronounced. So we call this a moderating relationship, right? So some of our doctoral students here can explain what a moderating relationship is. It simply means that the leadership skills of the entrepreneur facilitate the impact of his values on the culture. Again, you can be the best leader and the most decent person, but you don't know the economics of business. You don't price your products properly, you know. Like, sometimes you're so cavalier about your pricing, you forget that you're pricing below cost. And some amateur business people don't pay attention to pricing. For them, as long as the product is moving, they're doing well. But you know, you have to incorporate not just the cost of the goods, but the overhead, right? And sometimes we forget to put in overhead, and then we're wondering, how come I'm going slowly bankrupt? Oh yeah, I have to pay for electricity, and so on. So it's not just the cost of the goods, right? So you have to make sure that it's viable. So which means the culture tends to develop from the leadership of the business positively if the organization is viable. Because if it collapses, people remember how the business entrepreneur was so decent, but the business flopped. So they will tend to think it doesn't pay to be decent because the businesses will flop, right? We know it's not accurate, that inference, but that's what people tend to think. Okay, and this happens if the entrepreneur is skillful, creative. You can turn a problem into an opportunity. And notice that the viability is also assisted by the culture. What does that mean? If you have a high sense of commitment among people, even if you're not monitoring them, they tend to do things that are fair to the business, right? So they don't do coup it. When they go home, they turn off the computers and the light. So as I'm always reminded by my colleague, you know, so that's called organizational citizenship behavior. In other words, even if your boss isn't telling you, your concern for the good of the company makes you do it. And that affects the bottom line, right? If everybody was concerned about saving things, turning off computers, of course that affects the viability. And although a lot of this is influenced by industry practice. So if I'm a business in a particular industry, I ask myself, yeah, but are my competitors doing it? We tend to be, shall we say, affected by fashion, by practices of competitors. So that's the seventh hypothesis. So you can see that the theory is really a set of interlocking causal relationships, some of which are direct effects, some of which are moderating effects, and some are mediating. And of course, as human beings develop, they have more ideas, they have more commitment, they're more engaged, and they also make the organization more viable. It's like a flywheel. That's why I pointed out here that you have a virtuous cycle. Meaning to say, this takes a long time to set up, but once you achieve it, it becomes almost self-propagating, right? You just need somebody to start it, and then the culture tends to engender its own success. At least in theory, that's what the theory says. Now, let's go to that philosophical turn. I said that when I was developing that theory, I was doing it from a positivist perspective. And positivism, this is a diagram from Saunders et al. Positivism is the dominant philosophy of science in social research and even in management. But it is just one among several. Of course, we have the postmoderns who look a lot at discourse, how people add meanings to the things and realities that they talk about, and through this they create realities. Interpretivism is another popular approach, looking at how people construct realities. Now, later on, I will explain why I have seen the potential of critical realism, because critical realism has a very different view of reality from positivism. So I'm just focusing on the outer layer of this onion, because you know what happens when you peel the onion, right? Okay. So, but when we think of positivism, we have to look at the forefathers, the ones who started it all. David Hume is often cited as one of the thought leaders of positivism. And, you know, every time I ask students in their research, so what do you think? Are you happy with your research? Yes, sir, I have a nice correlation. Right? So they're happy. What do you mean by a nice correlation? Well, my result is statistically significant. You can see the light in their eyes. So for them, when variables move together, it's a good sign, right? And one of the first to propound this idea was David Hume. He said, causation is constant conjunction of events, right? So every time I push that light switch, the light turns on. Then I push it again, the light turns off. Then I push it again, the light. If I do this often enough, then I can say that pushing the light switch causes the light to turn on. So this is Humean. This is a Humean definition of causation. So this was the original. And then this was supported by Carl Hempel, the philosopher, who formalized this model, and he called it the deductive nomological model. Medyo highfalutin ang ano. But you know, we do this all the time in research. It just means that you review the literature, look at the general theory, and then derive specific hypotheses from it, thus deductive. But remember, your hypothesis should be framed in by using variables with specific names. That's why it's called nomological. So you name constructs, you build relationships with them, and then you test them. So if you look at my own theory, that's a nomological theory, right? It's full of boxes with names from which I can derive hypotheses. And then Karl Popper, one of the most influential philosophers of the 20th century, he said, well, if you want to advance science, you have to present theories that can be tested. That's why good researchers are always interested in testing their theories. In particular, they test hypotheses. And then how they do it was developed by these two gentlemen, Neyman and Pearson. Egan Pearson was the son of Carl Pearson, the inventor of the correlation coefficient. But these two guys invented what we all do almost with our eyes closed, which is the statistical hypothesis test, right? You all remember this. You state a level of significance, alpha equals 0.05, which corresponds to a critical value. And then you collect data, you compute a value of a statistic. Then you compare it to that critical value. And if the p-value is less than alpha, you jump with joy, because it means your hypothesis has support. Huh? So these two guys formulated that. By the way, when they formulated that procedure, they had this big fight with the other king of statistics, which was Ronald Fisher, because Ronald Fisher was never in favor of that approach. He found it too formulaic. Fisher wanted a more, shall we say, judgment-based approach to hypothesis testing. It's like what you do when you put sugar in your coffee. You know, you do patikim-tikim, right? That's what he likes. He will not say, oh, you should have this much sugar and so on. You know, you can taste it each time, and if you're happy, you're good. But some people criticize that and says, and they said, yeah, but that's not objective, right? Maybe today you want more sugar, tomorrow you want less. So why don't we just say 1 milligram of sugar, right? Because that's the mean sugar level that makes most people happy. Let's put it there. Okay, so anyway, even though Ronald Fisher was a bigger statistics giant, we all know the story. Pearson and Neyman won the contest because this is the dominant way that we test hypotheses. And most people don't even refer to Fisher anymore with respect to statistical hypothesis testing. Okay. So let's summarize how the standard model works, therefore. First is the literature review. We look at the literature, the theory, the past research, and make predictions using concepts and relationships. And then we gather data. We gather the data because we are going to test the relationships that we hypothesize. No? This is the deduction phase. And then we collect the empirical data. And then using the analytic tool that we chose, we compare the result that we have with our hypothesis. And then we conclude if our hypothesis was supported or not. And then in the discussion, we elaborate how the theory we use supported our findings, or if not, we think of possible new hypotheses moving forward. So for example, in the field of management, if you look at the Academy of Management Journal, the most cited article ever, and it's the most viewed article, is one which worked on high performance work practices. And he said, the author, Mark Houston, said that high performance work practices include comprehensive employee recruitment and selection procedures, incentive compensation and performance management systems, extensive employment involvement and training. And he did this for his dissertation. And after his dissertation, he wrote this into a very successful book, actually a series of books. Okay, this was the article. So if you go to the Academy of Management Journal website, this is the most cited and the most viewed article. And it was based on a very large sample, 1,000 firms, right? That's quite impressive. And it supports the relationship between high performance work systems and lower turnover employees and therefore higher productivity. This is a typical depiction of that relationship. The better the HR system, and they have a scale for it, the higher the performance of the firm. And they computed the market value per employee. This is essentially a shareholder value divided by number of employees. And, I will skip this and just go to this. So this is what they derived. It suggests that based on their very large sample sizes, if businesses pursue certain strategic initiatives, and this leads them to design certain human resource management systems that emphasize skills, motivation, and job design, this results in productivity, creativity, and more discretionary effort. As I said, is when you're doing something good for the company, even when nobody's looking, right? It's discretionary effort. And that improves operating performance, which leads to profits and growth, and therefore market value. So that's the basic recommended practice based on the research results. Now, how do we look at those kinds of results? If we're positivists, essentially what we're saying is that we have a theory, and that theory is a high work performance system theory, and then we're making a prediction, right? That having that will lead to lower turnover and higher productivity. And then these are constructs. Constructs are really variables which cannot be directly observed. So what we do in positivism is we develop objective measures, right? So this is the canonical way of looking at positivism. We're actually dealing with a very abstract idea called a theory, which is made up of relationships between abstract variables called constructs. But to study this, since we cannot access this directly, we use measures. And when we do that, we're interested in a number of things. No? We're interested in construct validity. Construct validity means we want to make sure that the measure we're using is really measuring the construct we claim that it is measuring. And this is a big deal in positivist research. We use a lot of tools, variable reduction tools like principal components or factor analysis, cluster analysis. And then we check whether the measures we're using are always moving together. So this is the Humean principle, right? What did Hume say? If variables are moving together, and of course we can eliminate other alternative causes, then one variable is causing the other. So this is called internal validity. Internal validity is also applied to whether our research design is good, no biases enter the equation. And then what is external validity? Here is where we're concerned about sampling, whether the findings we have for this particular study apply to other cases. So these are the kinds of validities we look at. Okay. Now let's look at how critical realism is a bit different. Notice in positivism, we look at cause-effect as being based on regularity, right? So if something is repeatable, we will tend to think that one causes the other. Now in critical realism, it's a bit different. You have an effect and then you ask yourself, this is called reproduction, what could be the mechanism that is causing that effect? And then you ask yourself further, what could be the structure that is leading that mechanism to cause that effect? And finally you ask, what are the other mechanisms that enable these mechanisms to work together? So it's a very different way of looking at research. So the focus here is not just on whether you have events moving together. The focus rather is on whether you understand why they are happening together. So for example, if I'm turning on the light switch and the light comes on, the critical realist will ask, but why does it turn on? So you'll have to study how electricity works, how electricity produces heat, and therefore heat and light emanates from the light bulb and so on. And then, of course, you have to ask yourself, how does the switch tell the light to turn on? Is it wireless? Is it a Wi-Fi switch? Right? Or maybe it's the sound of the switch. The click is heard by the light bulb. Just like some lamps at home, when you clap, it lights up, right? So in other words, if you did not know the wiring of this room, that there's a wire from there crawling to the ceiling, to the light bulb, you would have to ask yourself, how does the light know that the switch is on? That's what we mean by the mechanism. It's not enough that you're able to turn it on by mere regularity. You have to ask, what is the mechanism and what is the structure? So I'd like to think of positivism and critical realism as like looking at the tips of icebergs and then going below the water level and understanding the iceberg itself. So because we know that the tip of the iceberg is what? Maybe less than 5% of the iceberg itself. But we never conclude that the tip of the iceberg is the iceberg itself. No, you have to go. But it's very cold down there. So, Bhaskar, the recognized founder of at least the branch of critical realism I adopt, explain it this way. There are things that we see, we call them phenomena. These are events that we observe and we experience, right? So the light switch, the light turning on, that's empirical, meaning we can experience it directly. And then, but that emanates from certain events. In this case, of course, I'm making this up, right? When you press a switch, a circuit closes, an electron begins to flow, because we understand electricity. So an event happens. But if I don't understand electricity, I don't know what event happens when I push that switch. How does it light up? So a series of events happen. And then the real. The real are the underlying mechanisms that cause the events. For example, in chemistry, we learned that certain atoms have unstable electrons, right? So that when they're excited, they jump from one to the other. So we call these conductors. Copper, silver, gold, these are conductors. That means that electricity can pass through them because their electrons are unstable. Now, if you put rubber there, it will not work. So you need to understand that matter is made up of molecules, and molecules are made up of atoms. Atoms have electrons, and some of them are unstable. They're a little bit like, I guess, me. You know, if you have ADHD, you move around a lot. You cannot stay in one place. So a mere simulation, you move, right? So some electrons are like that. And when they discovered that, electricity was born. And now we all benefit from electricity. Thank God for unstable atoms, right? Because if everybody was stable, even if you're prodding me, you'll not move. No electricity. Well, that's where rubber comes in. No? So you need insulators. Insulators are the very opposite. No matter what you do with them, they will not move, right? So thank God we have insulators. So I think by using that simplistic metaphor, you can see why critical realism asks us to go deeper into what is happening. So a mechanism, therefore, is basically the way of acting or working of a structured thing. Structured things, which may be physical objects or social processes, possess causal or emergent powers which, when triggered or released, act as generative mechanisms to determine the actual phenomena of the world. So this sounds very abstract, but if you remember my example of electricity, so the structure of an atom, which we learned from basic physics, is that it has electrons, and electrons have a charge, a positive or a negative charge. That's right. That's why batteries have positive and negative, right? So that's the structure of these things. And because of that structure, they have certain powers. Already you can think how this applies to management, right? If I'm your boss, we are in a structure. Right? I approve your pay. So that puts us in a relational structure. And because I approve your pay, I have certain powers over you. Would you say? Unless you have a friend who has an opening. Then my powers are diminished. See, that's why the market for labor is important. That's why we need more businesses. That's why entrepreneurship is so important. Because if we have more businesses, those who exploit workers will have competition. You get it? But if we don't have enough businesses, people are stuck, right? So we need more entrepreneurial. That's why when I use Waze, I keep thinking, why did we not invent Waze, right? Because we have so many computer science geniuses among our young who spend a lot of time hacking government sites, right? And we all hate traffic. So we could have invented that, but we don't have the entrepreneurial support for our computer science graduates. The average business student here does not interact with the average computer science. I think we have a very good business school, we have a very good computer science school, but they are not interacting. There is no mechanism. Unlike if you go to Stanford or Caltech or MIT, you can see the businesses surrounding the computer science students, asking them, well, you want to make lots of money? Can you make an app for me? We don't have that happening here. In fact, I keep racking my brains how to make that happen. So the mechanism doesn't exist. These are examples of mechanisms when we advertise, right? Because it passes on information. People can act on that information, and therefore it makes them, they decide to buy. If a worker is given feedback, since he wants to do well, he will use that feedback to improve. These are examples of mechanisms. Okay, I like the way Cuellar puts it. This is a person looking at the empirical. Notice that since he's only looking at the empirical, he may not be seeing the actual or the real. So for example, the empirical is what you can sense and observe. Again, the actual are the events, which may be happening without your knowledge. And the real are the underlying structures and causal mechanisms. So this is an example. You have empirical data on increasing sales. You watch the department store, there's a lot of traffic. But when you look deeper, if you're the manager and you look around, you can see that the sales personnel are not chit-chatting with each other. No, instead, they're attending to the customers, and they're doing it so well, right? They're making cross recommendations. So if you ask this lady, I'm looking for a nice shirt. Ah, sir, we have a special on this shirt, and it will match your skin color. You know, they put the shirt on you. And by the way, if you want a tie with that, we have a nice tie. right? So you went there to buy a shirt, you walk out with a whole wardrobe. Because the sales lady is so responsive to you, and she knows everything, right? Now the question is, can a sales lady know all of that if she's only working there 5 months? And then she has to go elsewhere. That's why knowledge is a product of experience and training, and that is a product of humanistic management. So the underlying mechanism is possibly you have an engaging work culture and a supportive environment, so the sales personnel, instead of, you know, chit-chatting, they really attend to customers because they feel that the environment supports them to do an excellent job, right? So that's an example. Okay, so Johnson and Smith made this diagram to dramatize the relationship here. So, but I'll move along and use this instead. Okay, here, you remember our earlier picture of the positivist example, right? These are the constructs and the measures. And we said critical realism goes deeper. It kind of looks under that. So it does not discard measures because there is an empirical level, right? But it goes below it and investigates the actual, what are the events causing it? And then the real, what are the mechanisms? So in this particular case, let's look at a live person and see how this applies. So before we look at the case of Pantoco, you would ask, so why did I consider using a critical realist approach to develop the humanistic entrepreneurship theory? Well, the nice thing about critical realism is that it looks at action in context. Positivism always seeks generalization. Critical realism does not aspire for generalization because it claims that context always matters. Context meaning the conditions of the specifics. By the way, a side story, I submitted my article to a journal, and one of the questions of the anonymous reviewer is, but how do you know that this can be generalized? So there you go, which is my dilemma, right? Because if you apply standard statistical theory, I will need to have at least 30 to 40 sample size, right? Now, I wish I could find that many humanistic entrepreneurs. I wish. That's why I was asking my friends here, maybe you can help me find. But what happens if we cannot? That means we can never satisfy this requirement, right? But in truth, sample size can be misleading. For example, in 1969, the U.S. was able to put a man on the moon. That was the Apollo 11, right? You remember? Well, some of you were not here, so. But you can read that, you can Google it. So the question is, can man go to the moon? What do you think? Well, the fact that you hesitate means you're a positivist. Because how can I be sure? Because it only happened once, right? But to a critical realist, if you understand the science of rocketry, fuel, by the way, the computer on board the Apollo 11 had 64 KB of memory, which was considered a supercomputer at that time, right? 64 KB. So that's why I tell my students, because they sometimes say, sir, my paper is late. And I say, why? Do you have a notebook? You have this. Yeah, but sir, I'm sorry. Well, you know, the U.S. was able to put a man on the moon with a 64 KB computer. You have a laptop and you have a smartphone, so you're the equivalent of two supercomputers. So where's your paper, right? So, but anyway, back to the story. If we wait for 30 trips to the moon before we can say that man can go to the moon, I think we know that that doesn't make sense. All it takes for us to say we can put a man on the moon is to say that we understand the principles of rocketry, the principles of keeping the human being alive in zero gravity and so on. Or we can watch the movie The Martian. Okay, but that's but they say the science in that is quite good. Okay, the other thing about critical realism is it accommodates suppressing influence. Meaning to say, even if the events are not regular, it can still mean that you can have that effect, except that there are other causes that, that might affect it. For example, you will remember Apollo 13 did not reach the moon. They had to go back because there were failures in the trip, right? But the accomplishment of Apollo 11 was not diminished by the accidents of Apollo 13. We know that with sufficient funds and government commitment, we can put men on the moon. We know this without having to have the required frequency and regularity. It's really the depth of our understanding of what it takes to put men on the moon. And then the nice thing also about critical realism is we look at the powers that entrepreneurs have so that they can affect change. Critical realism looks at social change in particular, how people behave in certain ways. That's why if you refer to the recent elections, the campaign promotion was change is coming, right? So the question is, what are the mechanisms of change? So this is something that critical realism will really look into. And finally, it looks at reflection. Maybe for me, this is the most important attraction to critical realism. The problem with positivism, at least as I experience it, is that the actors are treated almost in a mechanical way. Meaning, if there is an influence on an actor, he will tend to act in a certain way. But we know that human beings are quite unique. Even if you poke them, they can decide to poke you back, to ignore you, to laugh at you, to even kiss you, right? So there's no way to predict how people actually will move, right? The standard answer is, yeah, we don't actually predict the specifics. We just predict it on a statistical level. But sometimes if we just use statistics, the problem is we don't ask anymore the deep reason why a person would decide to do something. And this is why I like critical realism. Okay, so let's look at the Antoco case. And I'll just fast forward to certain portions of it to highlight how he thinks and think of the powers and the actions.
I say that because I believe that even in this world where it's all about survival of the fittest, survival of the strongest, survival maybe of the alphas, if you are a nice person, I firmly believe that you can be true to yourself and be successful in this kind of a world. A little bit about myself, just very briefly. I became a retailer in 1994. And I think one of the greatest blessings of my career is that the team that I started with, the same men and women that I worked with when I started, are the same people that I'm working with right now, today. And so we've stuck together through thick and thin. We were in our 20s before, now we're in our 50s, so we're getting a bit old. But we're also in our prime. And we grew up together. We've survived great crises together as well. And because we know each other so well and we've worked so long together, we keep surprising ourselves with what we're capable of doing. So basically, the best way to describe us is we are ordinary people, and you bring us together and collectively we're able to achieve extraordinary things. And the things that we're able to do together as we keep working together surprises even us. Now, all our lives, we've been told by well-meaning people, people that care about us, you know, you guys are very talented. You're maybe above average smart, but you're never going to succeed because your way, your belief, and your approach is wrong. It is too idealistic, and you're not going to survive. You're too honest and transparent. You're too transparent. You share information when you should be hoarding it, because that's how to accumulate power, by hoarding information. You're too focused on relationships. You're investing too much time on building trust that leads to lasting relationships. You should be more focused on money and resources. You're too protective of your employees, especially when you experience crisis. And versus the people that you compete with, and you have to contend with these guys, you're not ruthless enough. And when you lead your people, and I'm talking about all the leaders in our organization, you don't lead them with enough fear. That's why if they're not scared, their tendency will not be performed. In other words, they were telling us that we were too nice. And in other words, if we are going to continue on this path, we are going to end up being another chapter in a book called Nice Guys Finish Last. And, you know, they were not wrong to a certain extent. They were right. Because if you choose the path that we did, it is certainly a lot harder. It's an uphill climb. It takes longer to be successful. There's a lot of roadblocks. There's a lot of additional barriers that you have to overcome. And there are many twists and turns. But we were not in this for, we were in this to do something great, but something great that we were, that would be lasting. It's not the kind of thing that would be short term. We weren't looking for a short term profit. And we knew that what we wanted needed a lot more sacrifice, needed a lot more suffering, needed a lot more patience. But in the end, we would build something that we could be proud of, and it would be sustainable. It would last. So along the way of our journey, we started from scratch. We started from zero. And today, our company is one of the largest and fastest growing retailers in the company. And as part of our journey, we were even asked to go on a suicide mission of saving a sister company that was larger than us. And we successfully saved that company from bankruptcy. But if you ask any one of us, what is our greatest achievement or our greatest accomplishment? I don't think, or our greatest strength, I don't think they're going to give you the answer that it's the 53 stores that we have that are in fantastic locations. They're not even going to tell you that our greatest strength is the muscle that comes from becoming a 20 billion peso sales company. I think that they will tell you, and we will tell you, that our greatest achievement and our greatest strength is the 5,000 jobs that we created. We have 5,000 employees, formidable, very strong, all very skillful and growing in skill. But most important, they care deeply about the company. They're totally devoted to the company. And they want our company to be their last job and the greatest accomplishment of their life. So with such a workforce, there's just no way we can lose, and there's no way we can worry about what's going to happen in our future. So how did we defy the skeptics? How did a nice team like us survive and grow? Or maybe another way to ask it is, how did we swim with the sharks in a ruthless environment, especially in a developing market like the Philippines, without becoming ourselves a shark? Well, it begins, so this is what we did. It begins with a higher purpose, even though we're running a business that has nothing to do with making money. Absolutely nothing about being the largest company or the most profitable company, because that is not sustainable as a source of motivation for people. And for us, it was twofold. Number one was quality for all. And basically what we wanted to do was quality, especially at the time we started, was just for the rich. Quality products, a high quality service when you're in our store, a great inspiring experience, a great place to shop. And we wanted to make that kind of quality accessible to all Filipinos, including the working class. And another one of our higher purposes was, it's really simple, to create and to preserve jobs. We said we're in the business, but we operate in the Philippines. And what does the Philippines need? How can we add value and contribute to the well-being of the Philippines while still running the business? And for us, that was to be a reliable and a steady creator of jobs, and also a promotion-giving machine. We wanted people to grow as well as to offer jobs. And we also, it also began with being clear about our customer. And it had to be a customer that we would want to serve and work for, that we would, over time, really care about this customer and hunger to know her really well and hunger to make her life easier, because we genuinely felt that she needed help and she deserved help and she wasn't getting that help. And for us, that was the working mother. So our goal was then to get to know her really well understand her needs, her aspirations, her struggles, and her hopes, and try to meet and fulfill those standards, whether it's her family or whether it's her work. And she's juggling these two very important responsibilities, and we felt it would be really, really motivating for us to help her out. So aside from having a higher purpose, help me. It also requires probably what would consider to be a different and non-conventional kind of leadership. And inside our company, we call it the shepherd warrior. And basically, a shepherd makes himself, just like a shepherd would with his sheep, makes himself accountable for every member of his organization or his flock. And he knows each of the people in his organization as intimately as possible. He's aware of their hopes. He's aware of their struggles. And in each of these, making their hopes come true, and making them overcome their struggles, the shepherd as a leader is very involved in that. And it's also getting to know the person, because in a diverse workforce with 5,000 people, in every person, regardless of where they came from, regardless of their income level, regardless of the school that they came from, or their religion, there is goodness and greatness that exists in everyone. And it's up to the shepherd to discover that and channel that for the good of the organization. And as you all know, CEOs like myself, one of the things that keeps us awake at night is ultimate profit responsibility. The buck stops with us. But a leader as a shepherd, even more than the profit, what he cares about the most, or she, is the ultimate responsibility for the people. And like other leaders, they take bullets and they give credit. The warrior side of this leader, it's a hostile environment, and obviously we have to organize ourselves to survive a hostile environment, and leaders responsible for that. There are many threats, there are many problems, and the leader as a warrior is responsible for confronting that head on, taking the bull by the horns, and not running away from these problems. There also must be a strong desire. You need to be very, very competitive, even if you're a nice team. You have to have a strong desire, commitment to win in your own, in wherever market you're trying to compete in. And within that market, mediocrity is something we should all hate. Average, above average, it's got to be absolutely superior. And therefore, we have to set ambitious and very daring targets. But rather than just lead from the back or lead from a control command center, the leader has to show that these daring ambitions are actually doable. But, and the risks that he's making his people take, he's taking it with them by leading from the front and being in the heart, especially of all the battles that are really key to the organization. And lastly, he never, ever gives up or loses hope. After the leadership is established, what follows is a collective belief system. And for us, it is it all captured in something we call wisdom, and wisdom stands for winning, integrity, sharing, daring, outstanding work, and a Filipino word called malasakit, which basically means loyalty. And I think I can't stress the importance of this. In a volatile, polarizing, highly opinionated world, with several ideas of how to be successful, how to survive the crisis that any organization or any team gets confronted with, you can get very, very lost. You can lose your track, you can lose your identity, you can get disconnected from your roots. And for us, wisdom is our roots, and every time we needed direction or we found ourselves going astray, all we had to do was go back to this, and we felt that we were once again standing on solid ground. But what does wisdom mean at the end of the day? And let me tell you what it means. It means that in every decision that we've made over the last 20 years, in the way we behaved as leadership, the way we developed our employees, the way we built our business and our brands, it was always about putting people above the bottom line. That's what it's all about at the end of the day. You're often asked, do what is in the best interest of the company. For us, what's in the best interest of the company is what's in the best interest of not the shareholder, not the customer, but employee first, and then the rest will follow. And then we did other things. We shared throughout our journey, we've shared success, we've collectively absorbed pain. You know, a lot of companies, when they hit a downturn, the first thing they do is lay off. So this is the point on collectively absorbing pain. We do not lay off. What we do is we take an across-the-board pay cut. The higher you are in the organization, the bigger your pay cut. Everybody's suffering, and we're all suffering collectively, but we know this too shall pass, and we absorb the hit for as long as it's needed. And when you do that, then that concept of putting people above the bottom line, people start to believe it, because they see you behave that way, and they see you make decisions that way, and what you get back is a lot more than what the company is giving. And of course, this is one of the hardest: help people believe in themselves and discover their source of passion. You know, in a force of 5,000 people, there's a lot of people there, but they lack confidence. And so it's our role to help them discover their strengths and their source of passion and hunger to add value and contribute from their strength and from where their passion. And you know, something beautiful happens when you do that. Work becomes meaningful fun once we find this. And if 5,000 people are going every day thinking work is meaningful fun, then you've got an amazing organization that can really go to a lot of places. This is no longer an environment. In order to be successful, it's all about rules. Rules stifle innovation. Rules stifle people. Rules suppress imagination. Growing minds, for me, one of them is about imagination, stimulating the imagination. And you certainly cannot do that in an environment where it's all about rules. So it's really about setting a clear direction, and then, rather than rules, define the boundaries. And within those boundaries, give a lot of freedom. And that's what we did, and that's why one of the things that we're proud of is we're considered to be one of the most innovative. And the other thing is inspire them and expose them. You know, in our company, we keep celebrating. We celebrate small wins, we celebrate big achievements, we do it in dance, we sing, we unleash the human spirit. We stimulate that and we unleash that. And we, no matter what we're going through, we never stop investing in our people. We expose them, we send them abroad, we expose them to training. Good times, bad times, the one expense that we're not gonna cut is the training and the development of our people. So putting people above the bottom line, I think we are at least one of those examples that actually proves that this works. And I guess in the end, and I'll tell you why it works, it all boils down to one thing. It becomes a pact with us and the 5,000 employees that are in our company. And it boils down to this: you make the company whole, and the company will then make you whole. And that's why when you put people above the bottom line, your bottom line is very, very good and very, very strong. So the bottom line is that in life, which is maybe can be described as a sprint with a moving finish line, good people can finish first. Thank you very, very much.
Could we turn on the light, please? Thank you. Okay, so of course, when I had developed the theory, I did not know Donny Tantoco or knew of the Shopwise case. I knew of others, but I'm nowhere near 30 cases yet. So I'm building up. So these are some insights that I took away, because I asked to talk to him, but rather than have a meeting, I instead sent a questionnaire, and he gave me detailed answers. I cannot share all of that here, given the time. But there's more to the story than he actually shared here, right? Because, again, what is the mechanism? Why does a man think this way? And how does he actually operationalize that in a company with 5,000 people? It can't be that easy, right? So you want to know the actual events that happen in the back. So in a lot of the things that he says, he always cites his grandparents and his parents. In other words, when he was growing up, they would always hear them talking about business. And in practically every other sentence, they would say how important the people were. And so this was something he absorbed, right? And for him, he always wanted to be a business leader and he wanted to express those same values in his business decisions. And now this is interesting. In the journey he took, actually, on some occasions, they did make some decisions that were not always aligned with their values. In fact, he did share a background story where they laid off some people. And then he regretted it because he felt it was premature. So when he reflected on it and he regretted it, he actually invited a lot of them to come back. And many of them came back and still work with the company now. But for him, the most important effect on him was, I suppose, is the experience of having, it's like those near-death experiences. Or when you have open heart surgery, when you come back from it, you're a more committed person, right? So for him, he felt that when his values were tested and he caved, in a way he weakened, but his ability to recover, fix it, strengthened his belief in his original value set. So this is what I mean. People are not predictable. They will sometimes act seemingly out of character, but when they reflect, they can bounce back. And this is part of the dynamics that I'm very interested in. So he used agency. Agency means given external events, you feel that you can make decisions that can affect those events. And well, this is interesting because that was a crisis. In effect, by going through that very difficult time, his employees saw him as even more human, and therefore he was able to communicate the values even more powerfully. So some social psychologists say that sometimes to emphasize a value, the organization has to experience a crisis. Because if the value is just declared in the wall, you know, in a plaque or on a website, employees think that it's really motherhood. But when they see it actually tested, then they really believe it. So that crisis actually strengthened their culture in a way. So I tried to re-express the theory in this way. So instead of the original positivist model, this is how it's evolving. So these are the generative mechanisms that I'm identifying. So the development of the moral level of the entrepreneur enables him to commit to certain values as expressed through his decisions. And then these actions shape the culture, right? So culture doesn't just pop out. It's shaped by actions and decisions, and usually in crisis. And if leaders reflect, their reflections influence their action. So this is an important mechanism, I think, behind humanistic entrepreneurship. These kinds of leaders are reflective individuals. They're not mechanistic, meaning they don't work out of a simple recipe. No? They're always thinking, how can I express this? And then, of course, business skills. He is a trained business leader, not only from his family, but he is formally educated. And this is also a mechanism. As I pointed out, he also had moments of weakness where he felt he did not always act in the best way given his values. So these mechanisms are all acting at the same time. And that's why the events that unfolded, as I mentioned, he did go against his values and laid off because they were faced with a lot of heavy competition. As you know, although the Shopwise invented the hypermart, but there are now many hypermarts, right? And some of them are really very competitive in price. And since he reflected on it and he was able to reverse it, that very reversal earned him even greater trust from his people and enabled them to overcome those difficulties. And of course, we see the tips of that in their manpower count. So they have 5,000 employees now, and their sales and financial growth are quite healthy. So this is where my thinking is right now as I try to enrich the theory And with each case that I discover, I try to enrich the theory even more. But I am prepared to discover new mechanisms that are happening below the surface that are helping entrepreneurs become more humanistic. So thank you for your attention, and I'd like to know if there are questions. So those who have questions will get to eat. So that's the humanistic offer. John, I suspect you were about to raise your hand. No. Yes, my friend from the back.
How many do you have already of the H human humanistic entrepreneur?
In my personal portfolio, I count about 7. So at the rate I'm going, I will reach 30 when I am about to die. But I suspect there's a phenomenon going on. These people don't declare themselves. They don't appear on magazine covers. In fact, I find that even when they're interviewed by business periodicals, they don't always explain how they do things. I suspect some of them find it, well, one, it might be a personal commitment, or some of them find it not something to really brag about. Which is, again, countercultural, right? If you look at business magazines every day, you see a man or a woman in a nice power suit posing, and he's being extolled as some kind of achiever, right? When we know that a business is a complex social system with many people, and yet you have the picture of one man there, or one woman. So I think in their heart of hearts, they feel that it's something that we all do together, so they don't really talk about it that much. Or, as we saw in the case of this man, it's so much part of him that he thinks there is no other way to compete. In fact, when I asked him in an open forum, he said, well, that's how we think, so that's how we compete. So it's like it's in their DNA.
Who were the 7?
If my memory serves me right, I may not remember all the 7, but those who are always top of mind are Elizabeth Lee of Universal Motors. They initiated the Your Van, Your Business initiative when there was a 20% downturn in the car industry. Instead of laying off people, she invented this marketing campaign. And Nissan, for the first time, outsold the Toyota Hiace during a business downturn. So, as you know, most businesses will think that a business downturn is a perfectly reasonable justification for a layoff, right? But for Elizabeth Lee, it was the opposite. She couldn't sleep. So she thought, how can I keep their jobs? And so the way they do it in ShopWise, the managers take a pay cut, right? In UMC, they also take a pay cut, if I remember my data correctly. But more than that, they invent marketing campaigns. No? And then there's San Jose Kitchen Cabinets. They have this nice profit sharing scheme. You see them in the malls, San Jose Kitchen Cabinets. And then there is, of course, the leather collection with Yulin Sevilla. And then there's Pandayan Bookshop in Caloocan. I think where I already asked one of my our audience here to drop by when you go down the LRT. When they gave a speech here, their employees now have homes. By working in Pandayan, they were able to save enough to buy homes. And these are lower class employees. There are a couple more who escapes me right now, but I'll yeah, of course. In my test of by the way, the theory has been tested in a case setting twice. No? Once by myself for Pen Shop, the old Golden ABC, the owner of Pen Shop, Memo Regatta. They have 7 companies. Bernie Liu, in fact, has been recognized by SME Nation as Bossing of the Year. So they. If you walk into any Golden ABC company, whether it's Pen Shop or Memo, they don't contractualize. One of the few retailers who really have a policy of not contractualizing. And there are a couple more that But you notice a lot of these are in industries where you think in competition will really be cutthroat, you know, like retail. But they're there. They're like rare species hiding in the bushes. So you have to ferret them out and use them for case studies. So, and I think a lot of it really is upbringing because they acquire certain values.
So yes. Actually your framework can still be extended because you started, you can look at the framework. No, the one in the virtue cycle. So to the left, because your entrepreneur's ethical development and virtues can still extend.
Yes, in fact, I'm working on the extension, but since I'm no longer pursuing a positivist approach, I will not anymore depict the model in this way. Because precisely, this nomological way of showing theories is a positivist. So the extension will happen this way. So this will increase in number of boxes in terms of mechanisms.
Suggestion.
Yes.
Maybe to look into education, is formal education, or because the samples that you mentioned seem to be more formally educated entrepreneurs. So is it a function of formal education, or do certain quote unquote grassroots entrepreneurs, but with humanistic values, etc., can they attain such? Also?
Yeah, that would be interesting to look at. Yes. In fact, if you know of such cases, please refer them to me so we can see whether there is a mechanism going on there.
You need social enterprises.
Could be, yes.
Is one of the companies human nature?
No, I have not really studied the management of human nature.
Within King?
Within King is in my radar. In fact, I had a 2-hour interview with him. For those who don't know, Within King is the owner of the Anito Group, right? Over 15 years, he converted the Anito motels to family-centered facilities, which I found really remarkable. So for 6 months, I tried to get an interview with him, and he's such a private person. Finally, I succeeded. So I interviewed him in the Legacy in Pioneer. And so he told me about his transformation. It was really a faith experience that made him pursue that. So that was, I think, more of a religious experience. And it went against the family's direction, and yet for him it was a personal commitment that made him change the direction of the business. So, if there are no more questions, thank you very much for attending the lecture. I hope that I give you a fresh look both at entrepreneurship and theory building. Thank you. And please, there are refreshments for you to enjoy. Thank you very much.